Okay. All right. What's a joke? Squag. Oh, that, yeah, it is. It is actually squag. Yeah, you're right. Okay. All right. All right. We'll let three people come in the door and they'll assume that that's how far did they have to go to do this? Just right outside the door. Okay, awesome. I really thank y'all for staying and being here this afternoon. It was quite an adventure getting here. I've actually been in California. I work in Austin. I've been in California all week doing some really intensive planning for our users and what's going to happen next for Amazon Web Service users. And in that, when Susan gave me the call to come here, I was like, oh, I got to make that happen. And I'm going to tell you some about why it's so important to me to be here today with you in San Antonio, Texas, and part of what makes San Antonio special in terms of user experience. All right, do we have any people starting to drift back in yet from the parking stampage? All right, well, we're going to go ahead and begin. Ready? All right, so you've already had a little energy, but I got to do my big beginning, right? Buenas tardes, San Antonio, Texas! Okay, there we go. Okay, so in user experience, I have had this very unique interaction and continual cross happenings in San Antonio. I'm not from San Antonio, y'all. I'm from Houston, Texas. We're up lower class, not ambition. Nobody went to college. Nobody knew what, you know, that there were options other than food service. And it was a real step up in the world to be a secretary. And somehow life took me one step and one step and one step and another, and eventually brought me to Austin, Texas, where I went to graduate school because I suddenly had a vision that a woman could be more, that somebody from my background could be more, and that there's something I could do. And I wanted to make a difference in the world. And I started in anthropology, which was the study of human beings, because that is what this is all about. And that is why I'm confident that each of you can make a difference in user experience, no matter what you do or where you are, or what you've been trained, or what you go on to do, is that you begin to think about the human being and that you make an impact. And I didn't like writing papers about human beings. I wanted to do something. And you see the nods of my colleagues in the field, because we all have this same heart. And you will find our field being one of the most heart-driven fields that there is. We walk into our own professional conferences, and there is this like warmth that just goes in and through and out of us, because we were all brought here through many paths to do the same thing. So what is user experience basically? So it's a practice. It's something that we do. You've heard some about how that's done today. It's a quality of a thing. So in San Antonio, and what Susan was just sharing in terms of SA.gov, what I got to hear Craig talk about 5 years ago when I first actually got to share the stage with him was he enthralled me with the concept of thinking about the user experience of city buses and transportation in the city and rethinking what it meant for a human being to move from one place to another in all sorts of situations and under all sorts of stresses. And he began to show me the community that lives here, the heart-driven place. And y'all, San Antonio, Texas is going to emerge. I was going to talk about the future of UX. San Antonio, Texas is going to emerge as one of the most powerful forces in the world of user experience. And I'm getting ready to tell you why. Aren't you excited? Okay. All right, so you've heard a lot about the measurement today and designs and experiences and what that means and that where it's at. So some of this rewrote itself on the plane last night. So every now and then I got to refer back to my notes. I'm going to share with you some of what I know about user experience now, but also some of what I hope that user experience is going to become. So the practice will change. It will change with things like AI. It will change with your broad experience because it increasingly becomes more accessible for individuals of all walks of life to do and to apply in their everyday work. It will become more DIY, as those of us in the profession call it. And that is individuals like you or like designers or product people or anybody doing their own user experience studies, doing their own user experience design, making your own suggestions, because technology is making that easier. And this is becoming more ubiquitous and more of a household word. The ways that it will also stay the same is that there are some things that will always be at the center. We will always learn before we make. Even if we begin to make before we think we learn, there's always some thought that goes into something. Last night I was thinking about, as I was thinking about, you know, that kind of future, it came to me that something called digital death. It was an experience I read about 10 years ago, some presentation, and you'll see a lot of out there if you search digital death. I recently bought my headstone and had it placed up with the family in East Texas. And by the way, I'd like to share what I put on as my epitaph. To give and give and give again what God hath given thee, to spend thyself nor count the cost, to serve right gloriously. The line from one of my favorite hymns. And I want you to be able to serve right gloriously. And you begin to serve right gloriously in user experience by pausing to understand. No matter how we do this practice, whether we do agile design, and agile design means like create something very quickly, put it out there, get it, you know, learn something from all of the complaints, from the screaming, and then we fix it, and then we do that all again, and we go on these fast cycles, or having the hippo make the, you know, tell you to make this thing, and you put it out there, and then you have to go back and fix it, and all that sort of thing. But we and you are still going to stop and learn and pay attention to who is sitting in front of you. You're also going to pay attention to more who's in front of you than maybe, well, than even us in our field have ever done before. So we're going to learn, and we're going to make. Don't be afraid to make. You have an idea for something, you sketch it up on a piece of paper, show it to somebody, make a picture, post it on freaking social media. It's like, show your own solutions. You have ideas, go ahead and use them. They're not wrong. They're ideas. It might just be the thing that makes a difference. So I was talking about digital death, and I had this idea that I got to do my headstone, but it's gonna be very hard still for my family to update me in my social presence and in my bank accounts and in my online world. And so I'm supposed to leave this list of all of my passwords and everything that I'm part of. And then somebody's got to figure out how to do all of that. And I've had to do this, and it's hard at a time when I want to be grieving. And this is what else is special about San Antonio. And this is one of the things that Craig began to alert me to that day, but also that I've seen as my own career has intersected me through this town over and over again, most recently at Rackspace. Before that, Pearson Clinical Assessments up on 1604. Before that, USAA. Before that, the Department of Defense out of Randolph, at Lackland, and at Fort Sam as soldiers were healing from coming back from the war. And part of what makes San Antonio special is your commitment to community. That user experience is broader than the individual that we look at and the individual we test. You have a commitment to community, to family, to heritage, to exuberance and joy. You open the space for grief, and you provide a provision for solace. If you thought that user experience was just the small thing that happens, that you change this button and this thing every day, no, user experience is a way that you express who you are as a community. Next. It requires three things. Intention. Attention. Let me add one more. Action. Solution. Intention. Attention. Action. Solution. The future of UX. It's young and old and so much more. Let me give you this one example of thinking in diversity. I mean, this city is diversity. I mean, you're representative of that. But here's an example that came up in my own testing through USAA, actually. Next. Today I was, or last night I was looking for just the right picture to put here to tell this story. And I was shocked at what I found out there on the internet. When I had computer and elderly, I saw goofy pictures of an old person leaning over a computer all confused. I saw pictures of an elderly person hunching over the computer, reaching out, and some young white guy standing over her, telling her what to do. Old hockey. Just a few, 2 days ago, I was talking to somebody who just did a presentation for the Jewish Elder Society. These men were all 70 and over. He said, they were asking some really intense and sharp questions. Technology's for everybody. What we design is for everybody. Why aren't we testing and looking at and designing for everybody? Why aren't we sitting in the chair saying, okay, will a shaking hand or somebody who's not in a hurry be using my site? Because that's what I saw one day when I was testing nationwide. And I sat down and I had these elderly gentlemen that came in as part of my participants. And I was forever grateful in my career that I had them there, because they showed me patience and that they wanted to read all of the information. I was so ready to go so fast and make things easy. Yes, of course, that's what we want to do. We also want to allow for exploration. We also want to allow for the physical capture of something when the body is moving. And if you imagine, or if I imagine for a minute, that that physical capture was just about somebody being elderly, 2 hours later, I tested a soldier who had been brain injured in Afghanistan, and he couldn't capture the button either. Think beyond what we have here, beyond what you see. Pause and ask yourself the question, who else? Who else? Who else? Next. AI will change some things, and some things it won't. It's a tool, it's a technology. The change that has happened is that the language has come into popular awareness, and now we're all asking ourselves the question, how can we use it? How can we apply it? It's like, ooh, whole new world. And so in that digital death example of my own, I'm thinking about my daughter sitting down and saying, okay, all I gotta do is say, my mom died. Here's the death certificate. No, maybe she didn't even have to say that. Maybe she said, my mom died, and it knows who her mom is. And it goes and it looks up the death certificate, and it tells everything that we set up and that we pre-set up. Laura is dead. She's gone on to the hereafter. Let's handle all of those things. And then my daughter can pick out the hymns and plan the party and plan the grieving and get the tissues and do what she really needs to do instead of changing all of my accounts. By the way, I'd also like to share with you briefly my family, because in the world of user experience, it's also a lot about love. And I am here today after this long trip and coming in late last night, because this is my husband, David. David means beloved. And David picked me up at the airport hotel this morning. He had a sack of snacks for me, and he brought me here so that I wouldn't have to drive on my own and so that he could be here as my support today. Really grateful for you, babe. User experience is about love. AI can't change that. So in AI, it's going to change some of even how we practice. So practitioners, this may just well write your reports. Let it. Doesn't that seem a little scary? My God, the first time I thought of that, that was only about 3 weeks ago. As I was thinking through this, I thought, let it. Let me do what I do. Let me do this. Let me be that voice in the room. Wow, that writes the stuff on the slide or in the document, tells the story. I'm going to tell this story, and I'm going to tell you and tell that hippo it's about love. Onward. In the world of AI, as it being a tool, a human, the human, we humans are still at the center. Whether we're at the beginning, at the end, somewhere in the middle, an AI solution, just so you know, those don't just run out there magically. Somebody thinks of them, a human, somebody creates them, somebody sets them out there, somebody turns them on and lets them run. Somebody pays attention to see when it goes wrong and fixes it. Human in the loop will still exist. You and me, we will still matter. And ultimately, everything out there will still matter, even if it runs automatically, because it frees us up to do the things that we are going to do for community, for family, for San Antonio. In that, so much of what drives us today and drives decisions is still the bottom line. But the future of UX is that it will become ubiquitous in a way that it will no longer matter that we have to track to profit. I'm still being asked to track to profit today to show why I matter and why I should have a job. But here is why I know this is going to happen in the future of UX, because we've already accomplished this in ways and are accomplishing it in ways such as accessibility, sustainability, diversity, and equity. This is already happening today, and it is happening, and it might get to some sort of argument. Well, this helps the bottom line, but the truth is it comes first. We have to do accessibility. It is now required because somebody like us made the argument. I look for the day when user experience is just simply required, because today we made the argument. This is the impact, the possibility that you have to be and do today. UX will always be about listening, paying attention to the person, paying attention to the persons. I'm going to change a little bit how you're going to think about that in just a minute. Onward. And I want to challenge our field. Our field so often now hires designers first. If you are my designers, God love you, we need you. It absolutely has to happen. You have to be there to produce the product. I want to challenge our field, though. So what happens is that now, so often, is that a group of designers get hired and they get behind because they can't handle all the research themselves anymore. So now we need a researcher to support us. Stop that. Hire the researcher first before you even know what it is you're going to do. Make them the first voice in the room alongside you when you first come up with the idea of we want to make life better. Because that then will put discovery first and not as servant to making something and getting it out the door. It will put the human being first. Do no harm will be priority one. If I do nothing else today, I want you to ask yourself one question before you let anything out the door, because we are not asking this in our heuristic evaluations. We are not pausing to say, is this going to do any harm? And by harm, I mean, are we releasing anything that has a little bit of pain in it that might cause somebody discomfort? And I'm going to tell you in a minute why you don't want to cause even that little bit of discomfort if you can solve it first. Do no harm. So I'd like to propose a 24-hour pause, that with any new thing that we are going to do, we stop at 6 p.m. on Tuesday. We do not hit release until 6 p.m. on Thursday. Because first, from 6 to 6, we are going to pause. The whole team step away. Imagine what it would be. The whole team steps away, goes for a walk out in the woods, out on the beach, has a little lunch together, does no work. But constantly in their minds is the question, did we put anything in there that might cause harm? If the answer is, it might make them uncomfortable, well, we can fix it later. We'll just put it out there and let them scream. What if we didn't do designed pain? What if we paused and just let ourselves get that maybe we did? The world is not going to stop turning if you wait another day or a week to get rid of the pain before you let it go. It will be about one, more than one user at a time. We think about that one user, and that one user matters. Next. And we design for that person, and we imagine for that person, and we research that person, and then we get feedback from that person. Next. But no one operates in a vacuum. What if every time we sat down to design something, we imagined who's going to be sitting around them? What's going to be happening in their environment? This doesn't just mean that we need to go out and do contextual inquiry. Yes, we love that method. We're not going to be able to always do it. We found that. We know the reality. But we can imagine it. Make that also one of our heuristic questions. Who else is going to be in the room? Who will they have interacted with right before? What are they going to do right after? It probably has nothing to do with your product. It has to do with their lives. But what happens with you and your product or your page or that one thing that you do, they're going to take with you into the next moment into their lives. This is my favorite. The future of UX, you are starting it right now, which is why I was so excited to see people who are new to this, because user experience will become a household word. But it's going to become that way in something that was born right here in San Antonio, is growing right now, that you probably don't even know about, but you're going to right now. The first high school program in user experience exists, is up and running, having graduates in San Antonio, Texas, USA. In the world. And now we have user experience people in the UK, in Germany, in Australia, and starting to be across the US who are buying into the concept that a fourth grader can be sitting in their living room with their parents, and they and their parents both know user experience as a practice, as a profession, as a career path, as something they can do that brings together creative self, analytical self, caring self, whole self. User experience will become a household word. It is about intention. It is about attention. It is about action and solution. User experience is about impact on everyone that is touched right after they do the experiences we make. And here, that matters. And even more important, there's another important person in this equation. The future of UX is in the mirror. Pause for a minute and see your own reflection. The future of user experience is you, and you, and you, and me as your you. The future of user experience is you.